chromatographies and double strands.
It's a great honor for me to speak at this conference and to be a student of Victor. We have all learned very much from him. And, in my case, I first learned about infinite dimensional algebras from his beautiful book with Rainer. That was before I went to MIT. And one of the striking things in this book is the Sato theory of the KP hierarchy. It was developed by the Kyoto School. So let me start with this. I guess everybody knows this, but just want to review it quickly. So we start with a pair of charged free fermions. C plus minus Z, or a BC system in the physics literature. The anticommutator of C plus with C minus is the delta function. And the other anticommutators are zero. We can expand them in terms of modes. Follows. And then this C plus J and C minus J satisfy the commutation relations of the Clifford algebra. So the anticommutator of C plus I with C minus J is delta I negative J. The one can realize GL infinity in terms of them as follows. EIJ is equal to C plus minus I C minus J. Then consider the operator S plus equal to the sum over all J, C plus sub J, tensor product with C minus sub negative J. One can see that this operator commutes with the action of GL infinity. And the KP hierarchy in the fermionic picture can be written as the equation S plus applied to tau tensor tau equals zero, where tau is an element of the so-called fermionic Fock space F, which is an irreducible representation of this Clifford algebra. Not going to explain everything. This is also explained very well in Victor's book on vertex algebras for beginners. Now, in the fermionic picture, this is like Plucker relations. That's why we have a Grassmannian. But in order to write the equations as PDEs, we need the bosonic picture. And this is the given by the boson-fermion correspondence. Fermionic Fock space is isomorphic to the bosonic Fock space, which consists of polynomials in infinitely many variables, and then other variables u, another variable u and u inverse, which is responsible for the charge. The charge of C plus is plus one, and the charge of C minus is minus one. So if now we transfer this equation to tau in the bosonic Fock space, let's say charge zero, then we get the Hirata bilinear equations. For the KP hierarchy. And the fact that GL infinity commutes with the operator S plus allows one to construct the so-called soliton solutions, which we saw a very nice animation yesterday by Alberto. Well, it seems that the topic of the conference is W algebras. So already here I can tell you about one such W algebra, W1 plus infinity. It's actually a vertex algebra, and it is generated by the fields jk of z, which we can expand as jkn times z to the minus n minus k minus 1. And they're given as, in terms of psi plus and psi minus, given as psi plus of z times negative d to the power k at psi minus z. This is, again, in vertex algebras for beginners. Actually, does jkn satisfy the commutation relations of a Lie algebra, the Lie algebra of differential operators on the circle, centrally extended? But in fact, the generating function of GL infinity is just psi plus of z1 times psi minus of z2. And so one can show that these elements also commute with the operator S plus. And so all of these elements, jkn, tensor the identity plus identity tensor jkn commute with S plus. And so if we start with the tau function, which is a solution to this equation, and apply this, so it follows that if you can exponentiate this operator, or at least infinitesimally, it will give you a symmetry of the hierarchy. So 1 plus epsilon times jkn plus and so on applied to tau is again a tau function modulo epsilon squared. So these elements of W1 plus infinity give symmetries of the KP hierarchy. And in this setting, they correspond to the Backlund symmetries introduced by Sato. One can also view them in terms of the Lax operator or the wave function. And they're the so-called additional symmetries, because they're symmetries of the hierarchy, but they don't commute among themselves. And as such, they were first introduced by Orlov and Schumann. Now, I should also say here that the KP hierarchy has important reductions. And one reduction, for example, is when your tau function does not depend on the even-numbered variables. And then in this case, one gets the KDV hierarchy that we saw in Alberto's talk. Okay, simple observation, which I think is due to Victor, was that if you take the adjoint of S plus, you get S minus, which is kind of like when you switch the two tensor factors. So you put C minus first. And then if you take the product of S plus and S minus, you get the Casimir omega 2, which is the Casimir of Jill infinity spread over the tensor product. It's the sum of Eij tensor product Eji. And therefore, the KP hierarchy can also be written as equivalently as the equation omega 2 applied to tau tensor tau equals 0. Okay, and this led to the Katz-Wakimoto hierarchies. That's my second part. So now let's start with an affine Katz-Moody algebra, G hat. I'll only give you the untwisted case, but this can be also done in the twisted case. So I guess everybody knows what this is. Well, very often people don't use the degree element D, but here it's really needed. So K is the central element, D is the degree element that acts as d over dt. So the adjoint action of d is d over dt. Ah, right. It's the degree, yes. T times d over dt. And, let's choose the dual basis of g with respect to the invariant, symmetric invariant bilinear form. Then from them, we can construct dual bases for G hat. That will use the notation A sub n is A times T to the n. And so we see that the Casimir operator in this case can be written as summation over I, summation over all integers n, ai sub n tensor product bi sub negative n plus k tensor d plus d tensor k. And so the Katz-Wakimoto hierarchy then is the equation omega 2 applied to tau tensor tau equals 0, where tau is in some highest weight representation of G hat. Well, Katz and Peterson, in fact, can describe all solutions of this equation. This is similar to the fact that for the KP hierarchy, all solutions are in the orbit of the group Jill infinity under the highest weight vector. This happens also here, but one has to use the corresponding Katz-Moody group. Or put differently, omega 2 of tau tensor tau equals 0 for tau in a lambda, if and only if tau tensor tau belongs to the highest component, which is L of 2 lambda, which is the highest component in L lambda tensor L lambda. So it's the module generated by the tensor product of the highest weight vector with itself. Okay, but if you write the equation abstractly like that, it's just this fact. But in order to translate it into a hierarchy of PDEs, you need, again, something like the boson-fermion correspondence, which is like an exponential change of variables. And in this case, this is called the realization of the representation. And, especially when the level is 1, when the value of the central element acts as the identity, there are several known such realizations. So from now on, let's assume that this is the basic representation. We have the homogeneous realization. Which is due to Frankel-Katz. We have the principal realization. Due to Katz, Kasdan, Lipovsky, Wilson. And then there are other realizations, but all of them were described by Katz and Peterson. In a paper with the title 112 realizations of the basic representation of E81. Why 112? Because they showed that for every conjugacy class of elements in the vowel group, there is such a realization. So basically, for every element of the vowel group, there is a realization, but up to conjugation, the same. And the homogeneous realization then corresponds to just the identity element. And the principal realization corresponds to when the element is a Coxeter element. So to get the Katz-Wakimoto hierarchies, one has to write this equation, but then write it for tau in a particular realization, say the basic representation. And so for every realization, there is a different hierarchy. So for E8, there are 112 such different hierarchies. As far as I know, it's not clear if they're all non-isomorphic. But it seems that they are. And, the simplest examples. So let me give you the simplest examples. Thank you. for SL2, again, the basic representation. For the principal realization, again, gives KdV. And this is actually related to the embedding of SL2 hat in GL infinity. So KdV comes as a reduction of Kp. And more generally, for G equal SLn, again with the principal realization, one gets the nth Gelfand-Dicke hierarchy. Which is again a reduction of the Kp hierarchy where the tau function does not depend on variables whose indices are multiples of n. And then another example for SL2 in the homogeneous realization. One gets the nonlinear Schrödinger hierarchy, which includes in particular the Toda hierarchy. So there are many interesting examples of hierarchies given by Katsuo Kimoto. Of course, we also know that there are other hierarchies related to Lie algebras, namely Drinfeld-Sokolov. And, as far as I know, the connection is still not completely understood. So I want to pose it as a question. How are Katsuo Kimoto hierarchies related to Drinfeld-Sokolov in general? The only other case I know is when G is SL2n, again in the principal realization. And then again, the two hierarchies are equivalent. Okay, next I want to use vertex algebras to understand the Katsuo-Kimoto hierarchies better. Yeah, SL2n. Yes. So what I want to understand in particular is what are the additional symmetries of Katsuo-Kimoto hierarchies? Are there, again, some W algebras? Do W algebras act as symmetries of the Katsuo-Kimoto hierarchy? And for this, it's useful to put everything in the setting of vertex algebras. So at this conference, there's no need to review the definition. So just for setting the notation, not definition, I want to say that in a vertex algebra, we have infinitely many products, A and B, labeled by all integers. And then often they're organized in a generating series called the field, y of a z equal sum of a sub n times z to the minus n minus 1. Where here a sub n is viewed as a linear operator on V. And then this is subject to axioms such as the Borchardt's identity. If we only take the non-negative n here, only n products with non-negative n, we get the notion of a Lie conformal algebra that was first introduced by Victor. And it was mentioned yesterday in Alberto's talk. So I just want to write that in a Lie conformal algebra, say R, we have such products for all n greater or equal than 0, And then they are organized in a lambda bracket that we saw yesterday. This is actually a polynomial in lambda because a and b become zero for large n. I only want to write one formula, the commutator formula, the bracket of am with bn, sum over non-negative j, m choose j, a jth product b, with subscript m plus n minus j. And this same formula is true but for vertex algebras and Lichen formal algebras. For Lichen formal algebras, you need to restrict to non-negative indices. And in fact, every vertex algebra is a Lichen formal algebra if we only take the non-negative indices. Okay, and again, mostly for the notation, some examples. First is the affine vertex algebra is denoted by V with upper K of G. K is the level, and when it's upper K, it means it's an irreducible module. So this is the module with weight K times lambda 0. And the second main example is lattice vertex algebras. V sub L, where L is an integral lattice. This means that there is a symmetric bilinear form on L that takes integer values. And if an element has an odd square length, then it's actually an odd element. So we need to work with superalgebras. And the fermions I mentioned in the beginning, of course, are odd. Here are some important standard constructions that one can do with vertex algebras. Let V be a vertex algebra and U a subspace. Then the commutant of U, or the centralizer of U, is the set of all elements in V such that An U is equal to 0 for all U in U, and then greater or equal than 0. And this is a vertex subalgebra. V, which is called the coset, or commutant, or centralizer. And in fact, it consists of all elements such that all of their modes, these are called the modes, all of their modes commute with all of the modes from elements of U. Okay, second construction is, if X is an element of V, then X0, the zeroth mode, is a derivation. And then the kernel of X0 is a subalgebra. But we can also describe it as the set of all A and V, such that A0 commutes with, that X0 commutes with An. And this is again a vertex subalgebra. Now the third construction, which may be not so known because I just came up with it, but maybe people know it already, is the normalizer of U. We'll define this as the set of all elements A and V, such that A sub n applied to U is in U, for all U in U, at n greater or equal than 0. This can be described as also as the set of all elements such that when you take the commutator of their modes with the modes of U, you get again modes of something from U. But in this case, this is not a vertex subalgebra, it's only a Lie conformal algebra. Okay. If we take now V to be Vk of G tensor with itself, and then inside this we can take the coset of the diagonal embedding of G hat, and we get the Godard Kent Olive coset construction. I'll call Ck of G. It's the set of all elements A and V, such that they're annihilated by Xn tensor 1 plus 1 tensor Xn for all X and G. N greater or equal to 0. Or we can say these are all elements whose modes commute with this diagonal action of G hat. And then a simple observation is that this quadratic, the Casimir spread over the tensor product omega 2 is actually up to a constant. One of the modes of an element of this coset, which is precisely the Virasoro element. So this is L0 of Virasoro, but for the coset Virasoro. And then together with the Katz-Peterson theorem, this implies that the Katz-Wakimoto hierarchy is equivalent to the set of all equations Cn applied to tau tensor tau for all C in the coset and n greater or equal than 0. Now, if you want to find symmetries of this hierarchy, we need to find elements in the normalizer. You know, something that when you apply to tau tensor tau, again, it will be annihilated by omega 2 or by the other operators. But I don't know how to determine this normalizer. So the only thing I can check is that if you take the Virasoro just for VKG, then I can show that it is in the normalizer. Choco and Cage. So we get that the Katz-Wakimoto hierarchy always has a Virasoro symmetry. And this is true in general for any level and any algebra G. But now, if we restrict to level 1 again, and if we consider simply Liest algebras, then we can do better because we can use lattice vertex algebras. And in fact, I'll just consider types A and D. Because everything becomes more explicit. So now the level K is equal to 1, and G is SLN or SO2N. And we'll just take the basic representation, then the Frankel-Katz construction of the homogeneous realization tells us that the basic representation L lambda 0, which is the vertex algebra V1 of G, is isomorphic to the lattice vertex algebra, where the lattice Q is the root lattice. But again, we need other realizations, not just the homogeneous realization. And so then we need to apply, again, the Katz-Peterson construction. And in the setting of lattice vertex algebras, this can be interpreted as having a twisted module over this lattice vertex algebra. And in full generality, such twisted modules were classified by Victor and myself. Well, in fact, what we did is for any automorphism of the lattice. So in this sense, we are extending Katz-Peterson's result. And actually, it's interesting when you have a Dynkin diagram automorphism, it's interesting to find the corresponding orbifold and its irreducible representations. This is something my student Jason Elsinger is working on. So in fact, the setting is more general. If we use outer automorphisms, we can also describe the twisted algebras. Okay, and but yeah, let's assume that sigma is an element of the vowel group. Now, I don't have to say time to say what's a twisted representation. Just very briefly, sigma twisted representation again has fields, the fields are allowed to have non-integral powers of Z. Where P is the order of sigma. We assume it's finite order. Well, if it's in the vowel group, it's fine. And then when A is an eigenvector of sigma, then only such powers of n are allowed, so that sigma A is e to the negative 2 pi I n times A. But then what's remarkable is that the commutator formula remains the same. When A is an eigenvector of sigma, the commutator formula stays the same, and even the Borchardt's identity stays the same. And in particular, when you take an element fixed under sigma, then it will act just as a usual module, and that's what's important for orbifolds. Okay, and so again, if we take omega g, omega, if we take the coset Virasoro, then we saw that the Katz-Wakimoto hierarchy is omega 2 applied to tau tensor tau equals 0, where omega 2 is again one of the modes of this vector, but now this is in the twisted module when acting on the twisted module. So what you have is that you can take a tensor product of two vertex algebras and get a vertex algebra. And M tensor M is a module over it. Sigma twisted module. And again, we saw that, in fact, every element of the coset will give us an equation like that. But now I want to find nicer elements than the Casimir. And they will look similarly to what I showed you in the beginning for the KP hierarchy. We saw that there's this operator S plus, and then from it you can construct omega 2. So one can construct similar elements here. And the general construction is given as follows. Let lambda be an element of the dual lattice Q star such that the product of lambda with any root is either 0 or plus minus 1. Well, such an element doesn't exist for E8, but it exists for all the other types. I'll show you for A and D. And then the statement is that if you take the sum over the Weyl group of e to the power w lambda tensor e to the negative w lambda, then this element commutes with, well, I can state it as that this element is the coset. It's not really there because it's in vq star tensor vq star, but it's the coset in there. Commutes with g hat. So, for example, for g equal SLN, we take the roots to be realized as vi minus vj, where vi is an orthonormal basis of Rn. And then we can take lambda just to be equal to v1. And this element becomes what I'll call lowercase s plus the sum of e to the power vi tensor e to the power negative vi. And for g equal SO2n, the roots are vi minus vj and plus minus vi plus vj. We can take again lambda equal v1, and we'll get s equal s plus plus s minus, where didn't say what's s minus. Well, you get s minus if you take here lambda equal negative v1. S minus is when you put the minus first and then the plus. So it's very similar to what we had in the beginning. Well, in fact, it's almost like what we had in the beginning, because if you take for the untwisted, just in the vertex algebra for S plus, the field is just tensor product of, when you have I pairs of charged free fermions, then you take the sum. And then S minus is similar when you put the minus in front. So these are I commuting pairs of, anti-commuting pairs of charged free fermions. So it's a BC system. And then the result is that the Katsuo-Kimoto hierarchy for tau in such twisted module M is equivalent to the equation S plus 0 mod applied to tau tensor tau equals 0 in the case GECO SLN, and it's the equation is S0 multiplied to tau tensor tau equals 0 for GECO SO2N. Of course, here I swept some details under the rug, because for the case of SLN, we need to quotient by the sum of all VIs equal to 0. So we have to do a reduction. Or if I write it like that, it should be GLN. But so this element S0 plus is just the residue with respect to Z of what I wrote here. And so if we do untwisted case or certain twisted examples, which I don't have time to specify which ones, but in the first case of SLN, this equation is actually precisely the n component Kp. Kp hierarchy. Well, if you don't do the reduction, if you don't quotient by the sum of bi equals 0. And this is something that was investigated in detail by Katz and van der Leur. Then, in the second case, one gets exactly the n component dKp hierarchy, which was again studied by Katz van der Leur. So you can see how much I've learned from Victor here. So we can state this result in the sense that the Katz-Wakimoto hierarchy is a certain reduction of n component Kp or dKp in this case. But again, we have to do it in a twisted module. We have to do the right twisting to get the different versions of Katz-Wakimoto. OK, I want to have a quick digression here. Other bosonizations. So again, in order to get PDEs, it's important to have a bosonization, you know. The bosonization in terms of vertex algebras means a map into a lattice vertex algebra. And so this is something that my student Daniel Fleischer studied. His thesis. I'll just tell you what happens for SL2. But this is the difference is that now we're working at arbitrary level. And when we put K lower, it's the Verma module. So first what we can do is we can apply the Wakimoto realization. To get an embedding in the vertex algebra generated by AA star. It's a pair of charged free bosons. So that's a beta gamma system, and then another boson B. And then this can be bosonized using the FMS bosonization, Friedan Martinez Schenker, or also called boson boson correspondence, and get the map into a lattice vertex algebra. Where L is such that it contains an element of square length 0. And there are two other elements, x, y, in the complexified in the vector space. So we need them to have inner products square length equal to 1. Product x delta is 1, and the product of y delta is minus 1. And the product of x and y is k plus 1. So this works for any level. And the map is that e is equal to x negative 1 e delta, f is equal to y negative 1. Negative first product with e to the negative delta, and h is equal to x minus y plus k delta. In fact, at the critical level, when k is equal to negative 2, you can take y equal to negative x. But you get this for any level. And then again, if you do the Katsuo-Kimoto hierarchy for this embedding in a lattice vertex algebra, you get something completely different, because it's a very different bosonization, and it depends on a parameter k. So I think it's interesting. Well, he's writing it, yeah, he's writing it right now. Okay, but now I want to say how W algebras act as symmetries of the Katsuo-Kimoto hierarchy. So again, we assume that we're in the setting of ADE, or even A or D. And the central charge of the central charge is n for the virus orient. So if we write again, well, the level depends. If you do it with quantum Driffield-Zukov, then the level is something else, which I don't remember. But want to recall. This is the Fagin and Frankel construction in terms of screening operators. So then the W algebra is defined as the set of all elements in the bosonic Fock space, the vertex algebra of the Heisenberg, such that E alpha 0, A is equal to 0 for all roots alpha. This is what Sasha Braverman used in his talk. So another way to view this is to think of this as, in this case, this is just the set of G invariants in the basic representation. And Igor Frankel constructed some elements here that generalize the Sugawara construction. I'll call them mu n of omega. Remember, omega was this element, the coset virasoro. So in fact, it's an obvious observation that if you take the map mu n, which takes A tensor B to the nth product A and B, then it will take the coset into the W algebra. So mu n maps the coset to this W algebra. And so remember, we constructed these other elements, S plus and S, in the coset. So what happens when we apply mu sub n to them? So for the case of SLn, if we take mu n applied to S plus, we get something like, again, the algebra W1 plus infinity, the central charge n. And it follows from the results of Frankel, Katz, Radu, and Twong that this generate the W algebra of SLn, which is nothing but the zomologic of Fateyev-Lukyanov algebra Wn. Now, if we take for the case of SO2N, again, we take mu n of all of this element S for all n in Z. And then by Katz, Wong, and Tian, this generates a subalgebra of W1 plus infinity, which I can call DW1 plus infinity. But they're not sufficient to generate the W algebra. One needs one more element, which is very easy to describe. It's just the normally ordered product of this Heisenberg, of the basis vectors in the Heisenberg. And then Katz, Wong, and Tian showed that all of these elements generate the W algebra of SO2N. OK, now using this fact and this theorem, the description of Katz-Okimoto in terms of S plus and S minus, one can show that it's not easy. It's easy to see that S plus 0 applied to all these elements is equal to 0. And similarly, in the second case, if you use S 0 applied to mu n S 0. But for this other element, nu, it's actually even easier. Nu even commutes with everything. And so from here, one can see that for every element of the W algebra, in this case, first, if G is SLN, we have that all the modes of W commute with S plus 0. And second, for G equal SO2N, all the modes of W commute with S0. OK, this is in the untwisted representation. But again, the commutator formula remains the same in the twisted representations as well. So from here, we see that this is also true in all twisted representations. And therefore, we can see that the W algebra in this case acts as symmetries of the Katz-Okimoto hierarchy. OK. Now, the motivation for all of this was actually from Gromov-Witten theory and Frobenius manifolds and so on. They have results about W constraints for simple singularities. But I can just briefly say that there's a theorem by Edward Frankel, Giventhal, and Milanov that in this case, one has a solution of the Katz-Okimoto hierarchy. What I showed with Milanov is that it also satisfies W constraints. It's killed by all W sub n for non-negative n. But this just motivated me to investigate more generally how W algebras act as symmetries of Katz-Okimoto. But yes, I'll stop here. Thank you.